Hello everyone, my name is Dani Kaya and I'm from third year computer department. So I wholeheartedly welcome you all in today's session. So I'll get started. So session agenda. So what we will be learning from this session. So we will be learning about what is cloud. Services provided by cloud, Google Cloud Console. Then we will also be looking a few things into Google Cloud Engine, Kubernetes Engine. And then at the end, we have a small activity which is related to our session. And we will be doing that through slido.com. And at the end, we will be having Q&A session. So let's get started. Now, like why do we require cloud? So let's understand this first. So whenever you want to host any project or any computational workload, we require resources on which that execution can happen. So basically in IT industries, these executions these executions on premise inside their server setup. That is called as on-premise infrastructure. So all these executions in IT industries are done are happening on that. But what is another alternative for this? So basically, another alternative is you may execute these workloads in the resources which is hosted by someone else. For example, Google Cloud. So that is where the concept of cloud comes in picture. So let's understand this with an example of Pokemon Go. So I hope like everybody might know about Pokemon Go game. So this Pokemon game, this Pokemon Go company or a person who created this game. So basically he or she launched this game in the through GCP. They launched this game through Google Cloud platform. And what actually they might have thought is like their expectation was they will get 100 users. Like their expectation was they will get 100 users at a time. So they will be working handling 100 people at a time. So it was their expectation. But suddenly they got 500 users. So now how these things will be managed? So basically with Google Cloud platform, it provided them with a variety of applications, variety of infrastructure related support using which the application can be handled. So since they had implemented their application on Google Cloud or a Google Cloud platform, so similarly the number of servers they needed which was making them issue was handled by Google Cloud. Now so basically load balancers will be required, like which will include all basically load balancers will include all the incoming requests and distribute them according to the nearest gaming servers to those of users. So basically on Google Cloud platform they offer us with a range of services that we will be looking into it now. So basically Google Cloud is a pool of resources provided by some third party vendors such as Google, Microsoft, Amazon, or any other third party vendor. So they provide us with these resources. Now, whatever services you are using into these cloud services, so you're basically going to just pay for those services. If you're just launching your product or launching your application in a just for a storage stuff. So you're just going to pay for that much area of cloud. Now, we will understand all these services which is provided by Google, that is infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. So let's understand this one by one. So to understand infrastructure as a service, I have an example for you that when you purchase a new laptop, so what you basically do is like if you're a Linux person, then you will go and install your favorite flavor in it. You will do memory setup, networking, and all these power setups and stuff like whatever configurations you want in your laptop, you will be doing that. Now, so basically, we are using infrastructure as a service where we want to have full control over our machine. So, now what if we want to do exactly the same thing in our Google Cloud? So what we will be doing is, through virtual machines, we can control whatever we want to configure in our product. So whatever configurations you want as per your need, you can do all these changes. So that is what basically says infrastructure as a service. So through virtual instances, we can manage all these configurations, and IaaS also allows us to share resources by virtualizing the hardware. Now let's understand platform as a service. So to explain this, I have an example for you people that I hope like many of us are from engineering department. So in our at the end of our journey, that during final year, we need to make a project and we need to submit it to our faculty members. So basically, we have developed an application which supports e-commerce company in terms of product listing and all those stuff. So when it comes to cloud, cloud-based implementation, what will you do is just submit your application, which we might have made using Python or Java, on Google Cloud Platform. So basically using platform as a service, you can depending on how many users are using your application, automatically Google Cloud Platform will provide you with enough size of memory, number of servers, and all the required infrastructure behind the scene. So classic example for this is App Engine. So you as an application developer, you will simply develop your application, and then you just need to host it on the platform as a service, like in the App Engine, and that's it. You don't need to worry about size, memory configurations, and all these stuff. All these worries will be automatically taken away from you with the platform as a service. So basically, App Engine provides access to programming services. Now let's understand software as a service. So basically here what we need to do, in this part you provide an entire application and cloud environment. So as we all know about Gmail, Android, Play Store, Google Maps, and all these applications are implemented using managed way of cloud environment. Now this is the reason why Google Maps can scale millions of people at a time, and Gmail is sending us hundreds of emails from different locations. So you don't need to manage your own infrastructure. You just need to use managed services instead. Similarly, we also have some services such as BaaS, that is backend as a service, FaaS, that is function as a service, and DaaS, that is database as a service. So all through all these services, we are working on we will be working on our cloud environment. Now, so now to work on these services, we basically need to have a unique project ID. So, I'll be showing you that what kind of project ID and where it is located in our cloud platform. Okay, so we can see our project IDs will be shown in our we will invite us the unique username and some unique password and also an project ID. So yeah, here you go. So basically, this username, for a while to work on into this lab, we are provided with a unique username and a password. And through this project ID, we are working on, work on our projects. Now, why we need this project ID? Basically, we need this project ID to track resources and quota usage to enable billing. As I said while explaining about cloud, that we will be paying for for the services which we are using. So we will require this project ID to enable billing, to manage permissions and credentials, and also to enable all the services and APIs. To enable any kind of services, we are using it on the cloud shell. So we will require unique project ID. Now, what is Google Cloud Identity and Access Management defines? So basically, there is a section in the cloud shell that says that IAM and admin. So it decides who can do what on which resources. So basically, there are four types of roles in it: owner and editor role, a viewer role, and a billing role. So owner decides what kind of activities will be done by the editor, and the unique project ID which the editor has. Owner adds that unique project ID to make that person editor of their project. So simultaneously, four of them can work on a particular project, and viewer role can just view the project and he cannot do any kind of changes in it. And a billing role just says that, as I said about the services which we need to pay for it. So whichever services we are working on, billing will do manage all those required stuff. And we also in the in the Cloud Shell, we also have a navigation menu, which is also known as an hamburger menu. And we to store our stuff, we have a storage part in it. So basically, buckets to store our stuff, like whatever need we want to store it, we have a bucket called bucket wherein basically in bucket you can organize your data, you can control access to your data. So basically it's a container which holds your data. Okay, now I hope till this point everyone is here with me. All right. Okay, so let's move ahead. Now, while when you launch your application, so basically you are launching it in a particular region. So like if I want my application to available for only Asia region. So I can even do these kind of changes in it, and we can also create our zones as well. So you can launch cloud services in different regions for high availability and reliability. So it will run faster in these particular regions. Now, what is a virtual machine? So basically, virtual machine is a software-based computer. Now, and like a physical computer, it has CPU, memory, operating system, all these stuff we know that a physical computer have. So basically, a virtual machine uses physical resources of the host that is running on every virtual machine that has virtual devices and that provide same functionality or a hardware. So for example, you can launch a virtual machine, run applications for some time, and then destroy it, no longer in need. Basically, this is this role is played by these functions by now next up this tour is not working for now. I'll try it once again so that I can show you people like what actually Cloud Shell is. So okay, probably my Quick Lab is not working currently, so I need to look into it. Okay, so let's just continue with our PPT itself. So now, we all know about Cloud Shell, and by using a command, we can go into our project and we can do all the changes we want to make it in our project by just putting all the commands. So basically, there are three ways, not only Cloud Shell, So there are three ways through which we can go into our we can use cloud services. That is a Google Cloud Platform, a Cloud Shell, and also a third-party RESTful API. So through all these, in these ways, we can get access to a cloud environment. Now, I hope you people might have worked on Quick Labs as well, so you already know like what actually it is. But if not possible, that I'll make it a YouTube video again, and I'll share it with you people to explain the stuff which is inside our Google Cloud Platform. Now, basically, what is containers? So imagine something with me that if you might have seen a merchant navy ship. So wherein so many containers are placed in it. Now keep visualizing that ship with me. So basically there is a person named as Hiltzman. So basically Hiltzman is a person who accurately determined how many containers can be loaded, how many containers to be loaded, in which order we want to load it, and how optimally these containers can be uploaded on ship. So basically this ship visits different ports, and lots of containers gets offloaded and some gets uploaded. So all these activities will be happening in a particular efficient time. So basically the entire process is of how you're arranging those containers, how quickly offloading and uploading can be done, and what maximum capacity you actually achieving from it. So if we consider Hiltzman's duty, the person is totally focused on how many containers to load, how to load, where to place them, how to organize the space in efficient manner so that maximum profit can be gained. So all these work is done by the Hiltzman, and he manages all the whichever containers they are loading in it. Now the exactly the same concept we are going to we apply to our Kubernetes. So a lot of application dependencies are based on operating system. So whenever we consider a huge applications which are being developed, then lot of time as developers you spend time determining operating system dependencies, working on resources, and so many other stuff, and that is time. So that is where container based basically these containers offer both the services, that is flexibility and scalability. Flexibility which is provided us by infrastructure as a service. So in infrastructure service we get flexibility in our product, and through platform as a service we are getting scalability. So basically we are combining both of these services together. Now with containers, what you can do? So you can define your own hardware or operating system and software stack configuration, and treat the operating system and hardware as a black box, and go from there to staging to production or your laptop to the cloud without changing or rebuilding anything. Now So basically what is happening here is our operating system basically is not visible to your application, and the containers used in application logic with required libraries. So we can see here with required libraries as a part of bundle, we are going to implement it. Okay, so you may implement this on a single laptop or multiple machines or cloud or any normal on-premise infrastructure anywhere. This type of application can deployed very quickly. So basically, with a common host configuration, we can deploy containers. We can deploy containers on a group of servers that is called as a cluster. So now the question arises: is what is a cluster? So basically, a cluster is a group or a bunch of nodes that run your containerized application. You manage the cluster and everything it includes. So in simple words, I can say you manage your own application. It consists of one master node and a number of working nodes. Basically, we are using Kubernetes APIs to deploy container on set of nodes. So we can see it here. Kubernetes is a managed service for Kubernetes. It enables rapid application development. So through this Kubernetes API, we deploy our container on a set of nodes. Now the question arises is what is nodes? Basically, a node may be either a virtual or physical machine depending on the cluster. A node can have n number of pods in it, and the master node, like we can see it here, a master node can handle the scheduling part of the pods across each node in the cluster. Now what is pod? Basically, pod is when you deploy a container. When you deploy a container on nodes, as I said, we use Kubernetes API to APIs to deploy our container. So basically, when you deploy your container on nodes, so what happens is you use a wrapper, and that is called as pods. So we can see it here. Now, in short, I can say a pod represents a group of containers of the same pod and will share same resource. It is a group of containers, and it will it has the same pod, and it will share same resources and the local network. So basically, pods are called as an atomic unit of Kubernetes. It is used as a unit of replication. So we can see it here, and Docker is a tool which is used to create our container. And Kubernetes makes it easy to orchestrate many containers on many hosts. I can say it is an open source container management platform. So basically, Kubernetes do the same work as our Hillsman was doing in our merchant navy ship example. So it basically determines how many containers to load, how to place them, how much profit it can be, we can gain from it. So it is the same orchestration work done by our Kubernetes. Now, next up we have is benefits of couponing. So there are six. There are probably there are many benefits of. But for now, I have listed six benefits of Kubernetes. That is, first we will look into it one by one. So basically, service discovery and loading load balancing. Kubernetes can expose a container using a domain name system or using its own IP address. So if the traffic to a container is high, so Kubernetes is able to load balance it and distribute the network traffic so that the deployment becomes stable. Now next we have is storage orchestration. So in this, Kubernetes allows us to automatically mount a storage system of our own choice, and such as local storage, public cloud provider, virtual private cloud, and many more these storage orchestration. Third up we have is automated roles and rollbacks. So basically, automated rolls out changes that the monitor health of your monitoring health of your application, ensuring all instances don't fail or don't go down simultaneously. So if something goes wrong, Kubernetes automatically rolls back the changes. So as we've seen this kind of issues in our Pokemon Go example, wherein like we were facing some issues, but that was handled by our cloud services. Next is automated bin packing. So you provide Kubernetes with a cluster of nodes. Okay, we had a talk about it, that it can use to basically these nodes and all these stuff, we are using it to run our containerized tasks. So we can say you can tell Kubernetes how much CPU and memory RAM or each container needs. So basically Kubernetes will fit onto your nodes to make the best use of your resources. And the fifth one we have is self-healing. So basically Kubernetes restarts container, replaces container, terminates the container that don't respond to user demand health checks, and doesn't advertise them to clients until they are ready to serve. Six, we have a secret and configuration management. So basically, it lets you store and manage sensitive things such as passwords, auth tokens, and SSH and API keys. So basically, all these sensitive informations it has. So you can deploy and update secrets and application configurations without rebuilding your container image and without exposing secrets in your stack configuration. So basically, all these we can take advantages of all these benefits which are provided by our Kubernetes. Next we have is our activity time. So guys, open your browser and just type www.sara.com and enter this event code 24947 and let me know your favorite example from today's session. Okay, now let's stretch the poll. I hope you all are ready with an example I have used. Okay, so here we can see, okay, laptop configuration, Pokemon Go example, Merchant Navy ship, okay. Okay, so, next we have is a question answer session. So ask your questions, like whatever questions you have in your mind. I'll try my best to solve that out. Link is our link is available in the description. Any question, guys? Okay, so if you don't have any questions, and if you want to ask me later, you can like ping me on our social media accounts. So I'll try my best to like answer your questions. Okay, we have one question. How do I get started with it? Okay. You can start with it through Quick Labs, and basically Quick Labs is a place where you go through all these services. And that is the reason, particularly for now, like Google has provided us with a 30 days of cloud program. So if you want to work on Quick Labs, then you can ping me and I'll help you out that what will be there in Quick Labs and what services, like how you need to start with it. I hope I answered your question. Any other questions? Okay, guys, so just in the chat box, I'm one of my core members is sharing feedback form. So please give me feedback of our today's session. So please let me know what changes I can do in myself, and also like rate today's session. If you understand it, so please rate today's session. Feedback form is also available in our description, in our channel's description. Thank you so much, guys, for attending today's session. I hope you might have learned something from it. And sorry for inconvenience that was faced through while doing the quick lab stuff. Okay, so have a nice day. Thank you so much.